Okay, guys, let's look at these. First one, oxidation of a primary alcohol with carboxylic acid. How would you do it?
Another big three.
One big three, chromium trioxide, acetic acid, or sulfuric acid, sodium or potassium dichromate, or contaminant O4. This alkene going to the aldehyde. We have three carbons on the side chain. We only have two carbons here. Ozonolysis. Right? We need to cleave this, and this carbon needs to become an aldehyde.
No, it's a carbon.
BCC doesn't react to the alkene. BCC oxidizes an alcohol to an aldehyde. What's the other organic product here?
Carbon bonded to double bond O and then we just one carbon with an
formaldehyde. Okay. How would you on those two? Questions about those two? Yes.
Okay, so I didn't use ozonolysis for B. I used mercury and water. And then I wanted to make it an alcohol, and then I used PCC because
Used oxymercuration, an organic one reaction. Well, that would give, I'll drop it like this, boom, boom, boom. I'd give this alcohol, right?
Okay.
You add water across the alkene, OHB here, oxymercuration to get this alcohol, then what'd you do?
I use PCC after that.
Well, PCC will oxidize this and you'll get this ketone.
Yeah, but it wouldn't have a hydrogen. Okay.
You got to cleave, you got to lose a carbon.
All right.
And there's a carbon-carbon bond cleavage here. Other questions about these?
If you use cam and O4, that's considered acidic conditions, right? Not mild conditions.
Well, cam and O4 can cleave this.
No, for the first one, sorry.
Yes, any of the big three.
But if you said mild conditions, that would be wrong.
I said what?
Mild conditions, that would be wrong.
I thought you referred to this down here.
No, no, okay.
Cam and O4 would be fun.
Okay.
Any of the big three? Cam and O4, we'll do this reaction down here, but will this survive Cam and O4?
No.
No, you won't get that product. You'll oxidize that and you'll end up with the acid. Ozonolysis, you can get that product, right? Good old epoxide reaction, the amine attacking up top, mesenterically hindered site, opening it up. This would be a dash bond back now. This just opens up after proton transfer, and the proton is transferred from the nitrogen to the oxygen. How'd we do?
Did good on that the first time ever.
Question?
Since you have a tertiary reaction site, why would you not use the acid?
Because you don't have H plus.
SN1's not a choice here. There's no acid, and we have a strong nucleophile. Anytime you do have a strong nucleophile, it's always SN2. Always SN2. Look at the heading to that section. It should be there. Probably has an exclamation point by it. That's a strong nucleophile. That's not incredibly strong, but it's considered strong. It'll be SN2. You only do SN1. SN1 is only an option when you have acidic conditions. Okay, shows an Fischer projection. This is cis-diol, right? I just twisted my alkene. I got rid of the double bond, put in the OHs. And then when I drew it, ended up like this. I rotated it, we get this. That's it. If I could quickly tell you what that is, I say erythro. That allows us to quickly know what that is, okay? Erythro, right? Gonna give erythro. Question?
When you're rearranging the methyls, can you just like move it around no matter like the directionality, I guess? Because like, I thought you're supposed
one?
To like, huh?
Did you do that in organic one? No, you can just rotate these.
Okay. Just any way?
Not anyway. These can be should just rotate it. These three. I mean, if I pulled out a bottle.
Okay.
Here we go. Here's vertical. Here are the things on the side. These three can just spin. Okay? For example, right now the little guy is going back. And this is over here. If we want the little guy to go that way, what happens to this guy? It goes back. So if you want this guy to go from that side to this side, I reckon you're right to your left. Well, now it is. But now this one goes back, and that one comes over here. So these can just spin. On the board, these three can just spin, with that being held constant. Hopefully you saw that. Yes, we can spin those. There we go. COH is actually on the same side, and in official projection, we call that a rethrow because they're on the same side. Now we can quickly just characterize that instead of saying, hey, this is the high priority groups are on the same side. Well, that's what that means. Marvin?
It's still correct if you got the answer in because it could attack from either side.
Yes, yes. Plus an answer. Yeah. Could have showed the enantiomer, these would have been over here. It still would have been a rethrow. How many short peaks in this compound here in carbon NMR? Three. How'd we do?
Can you find that one again? Like the short peak? Like for carbon?
We've got this one ready. Good. Why? Why three, Tara? Because three carbons don't have hydrogens. Carbon with no H will give a short peak. There's three carbons with no H. Boom, boom. Okay, synthesis. Okay, main functional group here is an alkene. You're not going to make a benzene ring. How do you make alkenes? Pull out your toolbox. How do you make alkenes? Well, just from what? Starting from what? How do you make alkenes? What type of reaction?
Dehydration.
Elimination reaction. I don't think you know any other way to make an alkene at this point. Elimination. So you go back to something that you can eliminate. What do you want to eliminate? An alkyl halide? You could, or you can eliminate water. I went back to this alcohol. If you go back to that alcohol, you can envision coming forward by reacting it with sulfuric acid, doing E1 elimination, put the double bond in here. Okay, but I went back to this alcohol. At this point, I remember nucleophile carbon-carbon OH. So this can be a nucleophile carbon-carbon OH. And I can have this nucleophile reacting with this epoxide. Well, this is in the form of like an alkyl lithium or a Grignard reagent. Now, this would probably need two errors. Once these react, and then you have appropriate workup. That's how you get the H on. This we can just start with. It says if you start with the alcohol, you can react any other reagents. So we can just bring that in. But how do you make the Grignard? We eventually have to go back to one propanol. Well, that's going to be made from the alkyl bromide reacting with magnesium. How do you make this? Well, you can start with what you were asked to start with, reacting with something like PBr3. Get to that guy. And there's your synthesis. Anybody have something else other than this? There could have been other routes. I mean, this could have been a chlorine, and you could have had a chlorine here, PCl3 or thionyl chloride. You can make Grignards from like alkyl chlorides. Could have used an alkyl lithium. Questions about this? Yep.
Can you use HBr instead of?
I can't hear you.
Can you use
Well, what type of mechanism would your HBr have to do to get this product?
SN2. Yeah.
Good. I mean, HBr could do SN2, but the reagents PBr3, PCl3, thionyl chloride, if you look back at them, those were said to be better at doing SN2. HBR is usually more common when you have dual and SN1. But HBR would work. Just, these are, look at your heading in this section. These were said to do better at SN2. Other questions about this?
Yes. This is a general question, but like whenever you use KMnO4 as like one of the big three, what solvent would you put?
I don't know that you actually need acid for that one. I only showed you the acid with the chromium. Sometimes just a benign solvent like acetone, even like THF. I don't think you need acid with KMnO4.
So it's okay if we just write KMnO4?
Probably would have been fine, yeah. Yeah. But it's good. It's good to question about the solvents because that's the next logical question.
After the epoxide reaction,
but isn't it H becomes there's this
solvent. Yeah, you gotta have H.
There's a difference between one of straight up four carbon. These different solvents are that.
H plus four carbon.
I don't know
why that's
an
HCl. Water would actually work also.
Wait, what are you talking about? When you use KMnO4 for what?
For
what? For what
reaction?
For what you got?
Like the first reaction?
Oh yeah, you're right. Okay.
I just used it. It said if you start it with one propanol, you can use anything you want. I just used an epoxy. I didn't require you to make the epoxy. No, it's broken. Okay, let's. I got a couple of handouts. This is test two material. Okay, test two material, aromatics. Only one stack, one yellow, golden, one white. Let's see where we're at with carbon NMR. Questions on the previous carbon NMR pages? Okay, then let's begin here. Let's just see if I can assign peaks here. How many carbon signals do you expect from structure? How many from structure? Guys, you should have already looked at this and had the answer. How many from structure? Okay, the answer is 8. Here are your 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Which signal is this down here? Answer?
CH3.
Let's call this, okay? A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. What is this? A. It's the only sp3 carbon up there. Okay, down in the sp3 range. Now the baseline is 0 to 200. That's actually 20 times the baseline of proton. Okay, everything is just 20 times. These H's you would expect to be about 2, maybe 2.5 ppm. Well, 2.5 times 20 is what, 50? And you see this peak, well, it's not quite 50. Let's call this 2. That gives us 40. We're still, okay, maybe it's the 16 times rule. But it gets us in the range. Time is not that precise. B, what type of carbon is that? Carbonyl. Where do we expect carbonyl? Carbonyl region. 170, 200, 210 maybe. Okay, there's that peak, so that's B. What are these six? Well, they're your aromatic region, right? Proton, it's about 7. Carbon NMR is about 140 times 20. Okay, aromatic region. We got 6. Now, let me tell you this. We're typically not going to assign each one because it can be difficult in the aromatic region. It can be difficult. Sometimes it's counterintuitive based on inductive withdrawing effects or whatnot. What we will do, though, is we will assign short peaks. Of the aromatics, how many should be short? Which one should be short? C and E. Two, we expect two short. Do you have two that are short? Comparatively, yes. These two are C and E. I'm not going to say which is which, because that can be difficult. Like I said, though, sometimes it's not as, your intuition doesn't work out. It can be difficult. There's other things that go into play. Actually, in one of the labs coming up, we'll actually use a table to predict these. But from right here, we cannot do it. And you would never memorize this table. But you could look at a table and get it. This is what we're going to do here. Now, which ones are these? Now I gotta, okay, this is, what did we say, D and F through H?
Yeah.
Those are those four. I'm not going to assign which is which, though. That can be difficult. But we can assign the short peaks. But if you have multiple short peaks, we're not going to differentiate. This is how we're going to do it. This is how I would expect you to do it on a quiz or a test. And no more detail than that right there. But this, of course, we can assign, because that's clearly carbonyl. This, of course, we can clearly assign. Question?
Would the shortest peak not be E?
C and E. C and E. What letter did you say?
The shortest peak by like 145-ish, would that not be E because it's closer to
I can't hear the letter you're saying.
E.
E is an elephant.
Yes.
E is an elephant. Yes, one of these is E.
No, but my question is like, can't you define the shortest one as E because it's closer to NO2 rather than the other one being like.
Okay, I'll say it again. Yes, you can make a guesstimate, but it's often going to be wrong because there's other things going on. It tends to be counterintuitive. Your intuition is good, but it tends to be counterintuitive. The real answer tends to not go with that. Again, if you really want to assign it, I would recommend pulling out a table and seeing a carbon, everybody carbon bonded to a nitro group, where exactly do you expect it? And it'll give you a very precise value. And it will be very trustworthy. Okay. Other questions about that? All right, let's look below. How many signals did you expect for this guy? Yes, 5. A, B, C, D, E. What is this here? C prime and D prime. Okay? You have symmetry here. C prime and D prime. It's the same signal. Now if we add integration, this signal will be twice as tall, but that doesn't work in carbon NMR always. So, which letter is this guy here?
A.
A. By the way, carbonyl peak up top, wasn't it a lot shorter? Was it?
Yes.
Why is this one taller? This has an H on it. Aldehyde carbonyl tends to be taller. Of course, that's relative. You have something to be comparing it to something. If what we were comparing it to was that tall, then we'd call this shorter. This is taller than the other. So that makes sense. Okay, we have 4 here. We expect. But look, two of them are short. Which ones are the short ones? B and E are going to be short. I don't know which is which. That's how I'm going to do that. And these two are what?
C and D.
C and D. They're much taller because they have H's. They're also taller because there's actually two C carbons and two D carbons. Integration does affect it a little bit. Question?
So if we put C, D, and then like also C prime and D prime for those two, would that be wrong?
No, it would not be wrong. I mean,
like for
as long as it's clear.
Okay.
As long as it's clear. C prime is the same signal. Okay. Where are the aromatic signals? There are none. Well, we can do letters. What is this on the left? A, B, C, and D. What is that? A?
Yep.
How about this guy?
C.
B? Just like a proton, these protons are going to be moved downfield next because they're bonded to the carbonyl. Same as carbon NMR. What are these two?
C and D.
C and D. Now, they all have H's on them. But one of these is shorter, not because it doesn't have an H, but what's the reason? Integration does work some. Okay? This peak is for actually two carbons. I'm going to be pretty confident that that's D and this is C.
So would you want to do that and not say those two would be C and D?
Well, I'd probably let you slide because at what point can you tell? What if this was only a wee bit taller?
Yeah.
So I probably would not. It would probably be okay to just say C/D. But what I'm getting at is this is probably D because integration does work some in carbon NMR. And there's two D carbons, so you would expect it to be sort of twice as tall. But look, both of these are from one carbon. This one's much taller. That doesn't mean it's more area of the curve, but it probably is. One below, how many signals do you expect?
Five.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay? Here's your carbonyl. Here's your carbon next to the carbonyl. Probably just as you tail off, although these are pretty darn close, you could be misled. A, B, C, D, E. A, B, C, D, E would probably be okay. But again, sometimes you can be misled. This is an actual carbon NMR research lab. Yes.
On that last one, if you not assign like the one that was at the end, like the methyl group, if you not assign that as like the very last one?
That would be reasonable. Compound from my research lab, actual carbon NMR that was run here. Peak values are given across the top. PPM down here. See, there's no integration. You can look at how many signals do you expect. Whatnot. Just something if you want to look at it and try to evaluate it. One thing I'll point out here, though, is we do have a signal for the solvent. This is your solvent. And here we use DMSO. The O got cut off. Your solvent does have carbons. And it's the carbons of the solvent that are giving the peak. But note, the solvent peak, first off, how many different signals do you expect? Just one. They're equivalent. One carbon signal. Why is it not a singlet? It's actually what? These are all the lines for the solid peak. There's actually, I think, 7 lines there. Why is it not a singlet? Why is it 7? The answer is because it's split by the deuteriums that are on there. We remove the splitting to the hydrogens, but we do not routinely move splitting from other nuclei that may split, and deuterium will split. Now, the spin for deuterium is 1, not 1/2. Now, the N plus 1 rule is actually 2In plus 1. Nobody will tell you that. That's free information. For proton and carbon, I is 1/2. So 2 times 1/2 equals what?
1.
So it's 1N plus 1. You just get rid of the N of the 1. It's N plus 1. But for deuterium, I is 2. I mean 1. So here we go. 2 times 1, N plus 1. What is 2 times 1? 2. So it's 2N plus 1. This is your rule for deuterium. How many deuteriums do we have? 3. 3 times 2 is 6, plus 1, 7. That's why you see 7 lines. It's being split by the deuterium. And the spin of deuterium is actually 1. Okay? This is extra information, but hopefully you find it of interest. Okay? Also, if you look at a real carbon in the MR, you're going to see such. Well, not blindly. I mean, we have other information. For example, we knew what we were trying to make. And so, you know, it wasn't just blind. But you can look at it, see if you can assign some peaks. Okay. That was carbon NMR. You can do NMR on other nuclei, for example. I mentioned before, fluorine is very common. This is an example of fluorine NMR, where you're only getting signals from the fluorine. This compound we made in the research lab, and this has been published. How many different signals do you expect from the fluorines here? One, they're equivalent. And indeed, here's your signal. Since they're equivalent, they don't split each other. One signal. Now, fluorine NMR, you can't use TMS to set your baseline as a standard because TMS doesn't contain fluorine. A common standard in fluorine NMR is hexafluorobenzene. All fluorines are identical, so it only gives one peak. They don't split each other. It's a singlet, you set it at 0. And the peak, all your other peaks are relative to this. Now on the next page, I think we'll see a little bit different. In this compound, very similar, but here the fluorines are not equivalent because one can be cis to the OH, the other can be trans. So they're not equivalent, you get 2 signals. Not only do you get 2 signals, because they're not equivalent, they're now splitting each other. And fluorine splits just like proton. It's I is 1/2. One neighbor, doublet. So each of your signals here is a doublet. And all we're seeing is just the fluorine signals for fluorine. So just to give you a little flavor of some other nuclei. On the back, I give you just a reference table. If you're ever dealing with actual NMRs, you got to know how to deal with the solvent. Okay, I mentioned the solvent peak earlier. Real NMRs may also have water signals. Where do you expect the water to show up? It actually can vary depending on what solvent you use. So if you're using DMSO, this tells you where you expect a signal for the solvent or a signal for water in that solvent. It's a reference table. Okay. There may or may not be a time when you will look at it in one of our labs as we go along. It's free. There's no charge for that information. Okay.
Back to you.
Yes.
Do you have any more of the aromaticity warm up the white ones? They were like 2 or 3 short.
No.
of the day?
Yeah.
Are there any other white handouts for the day or golden?
The white ones.
I'll give you mine. I had to leave them on the copier. It was going slow. There's a few more on the copier. If you really want it before Wednesday, stop by. I'm just kind of giving you this deadline. Who's missing? Just one? Stop by. Okay. Let's see. About time to try to pull everything together. Were there other questions in any of the handouts? In the handout. Anybody ever get a J value for that peak in the carbon in the proton intermodal? Did any things we did not go back and answer?
Multi-step synthesis.
Yes, let's do a couple. Let's do a multi-step synthesis. That would be, I think, in the epoxide handout.
Yeah.
There's another question.
I think we did the ones at the top. Did we do this one? I know we probably didn't do these two. Didn't do any of these three at the bottom. Okay, here you're asked to start with alkene. Alkene. Maybe have to do some alkene chemistry. Let's start at the bottom. Okay, how do you make ketones? Well,
oxidation.
And there's one way to make a ketone. I think you only know one way at this point in your
alcohol.
Take this back to what?
Alcohol.
Take it back to the alcohol.
Yeah.
What we're doing here is, okay, here's the functional group I need to make. What are the ways I can make this? And at this point, you only know a couple of ways for most cases. By the end of this course, you may know a half a dozen ways. At that point, it will be your choice. Do it however you would like. I only know one way to make a ketone, though. I mean, you guys should only know one way. Tell me if you know another. I don't think so. I can go back and say, hey, if I get to this point, I know I can come this way. If I come this way, what would be the reagent?
CrO3.
Okay, just to change it up, I'm just going to say KMnO4. That will oxidize that.
Does it not matter? Or what is
it? Big three, they're all the same.
Okay.
Later we may have to sort of throw some caution up here, but right now you don't know any reason to be cautious about this reaction. Oxidize the secondary alcohol here, it stops here. There you go. Got to make this somehow. That's the only way I know how to make that in this class. Now we go back and say, how are we going to make this? Well, this is where I tried to get you to remember nucleophile, carbon-carbon OH. What could be the nucleophile, carbon-carbon OH? And break this down into, I'm just going to draw that as phenyl. Epoxide, that's your two carbons. And what would be the nucleophile?
Like a carbon ion.
Just a methyl, a CH3 anion. That's going to come in the form of what? Like CH3 magnesium iodide or something. Well, we'll use bromide. I think it would be easier. And of course, you may see me just draw that as ME at some point. Okay. So we need a precise reagent. I don't just want you to do this. A precise reagent. So, if we had this epoxide, can we envision reacting it with this Grignard? Okay, they react. Then we work it up with like some H+ workup. And that would give this. Hopefully you see that. At this point, we're saying, well, how do we make these? Well, what are you supposed to, what are the restraints here? What does the directions tell you? Basically, the directions are going to tell you, you make it from that, and if you make it from that, you can use anything else you want. That's what the directions are going to tell you. Well, how did you make this? How do you make epoxides? Most common is from the alkene. What would the alkene look like?
The fennel with the fat.
It looked like that. And all of a sudden, there you go, you're done. This is going to come from this. Because if you had that, you would just react that with MCPBA, make the epoxide, then you bring in your Grignard. Get to this point, then you oxidize it up to the ketones. And there's your multi-step synthesis.
Can we show the multi-step synthesis? Do we have to show retrosynthetic arrows, or can we just, like, if we wanted to say, start from this arrow and just do it like a regular? Or do we need to, like, show we went back? And
well, yeah, I would look at the question. Maybe it'll say show a retrosynthetic.
Okay.
The main point of the retrosynthesis is it's the helpful approach.
Okay.
It's the way to understand, because a lot of times I see students just want to stare at this and like, how am I going to make a ketone? You don't want to stare at that. You want to go over here and go one step backwards. Well, how do you make this ketone? You only know one way, and it would have to be this. If you know no other way, well, what other? There's no other route. Questions about this one? Now, it didn't say, the directions are not entirely clear here, but it doesn't say you have to make your Grignard. But if you wanted to make this, this would come from what? Methyl bromide? Interacting with magnesium? Well, how would you make this? I mean, at some point, you're just going back to like charcoal. You know? Or crude oil or something. Question.
Is there a solvent for MCPBA? A solvent for MCPBA?
Guys, make sure that people in the back corner can hear you.
Is there a solvent for MCPBA?
THF is a common solvent. I mean, in practice, you're going to use a solvent just about for any reaction.
Do we have to put that down there? Like we were doing a synthesis, so we didn't put that?
No, typically I don't require you to put solvents, but it is a good idea to always start to learn them and be able to recognize them. Okay, which one of the next ones would you like to do here?
First one.
Riley? Which one? This one here? Okay, how do you make alkyl chlorides? You actually know multiple ways. One way is if you had an alcohol, could you convert it to a chloride?
Yes.
So that's one way. We could take this back to that. Because if I had that, how would it come forward?
HCl.
Like thionyl chloride, you might be able to use HCl here. Thionyl chloride will work. How else do you know how to make this? Another way, if you think about it, is to make this alkene and react it with maybe HCl. That's a good old-fashioned organic one reaction. Addition of HCl to an alkene. But here's the problem. Everybody see that? That's an organic one reaction, right?
Yeah.
One of the first reactions we covered in organic one.
But it wouldn't. You had it. It wouldn't.
It wouldn't be what?
It wouldn't like have any
Yeah, it would, because that's going to be a resin stabilized cation.
Oh, okay. Right.
Resin stabilized cation is highly preferred. Fluorine intact there. Yeah. Yes, they're both monosaccharides. Problem is, how would you make the alkene? How do you know how to make alkenes?
Elimination.
So what are you going to do? Back it up to maybe that? Let's eliminate and then add HCl. You're going in circles there, right? The only way you know how to make alkenes is to eliminate. What would you eliminate? You see what I'm saying here?
Yeah.
This is a better route. Think about that. This is a better route because also now you have nucleophile carbon-carbon OH. And as I said, this and synthesis, by the way, is in which handout? The epoxide handout. For a reason. Because now we can back this up to This epoxide plus what? And these two? Okay, the same way with workup. But look, this is the same as that. So we already know how to make that. Okay? So this synthesis involves alkene to the epoxide, then reacting it with this Grignard, then just converting the OH to the alkyl halide. This is actually the same we did before, except down here, instead of converting this to the alkyl chloride, we oxidized it with the ketones.
That was the only difference in the two.
The one above, what's the main functional group? Ether. Ether, how do you make ethers? Here?
Oh, I'll put it.
I'll let you do that one on your own. Let's see what else we can look at today. This was the NMR I gave you on the pre-course worksheet. It's a comprehensive spec problem. This is what you'll see on the test, and there's several of these in the workbook. Please read the instructions. Very similar to what you'll see on the test. Chemical test meaning. That is, what does the chemical test tell you? What does it mean to you? We're pushing out of time. I don't think we have time to get into this. Any questions about this type of problem, though? Well, just like we went through and we did some that just had proton NMR. But a couple of those that we did also had an IR associated with it. Okay? Just think there. How did we address that? And was it overwhelming? No, don't let it be overwhelming. Each spectra provides some good information. I mean, just start assessing. Now, ultimately, I'm going to focus on the HNMR. You could probably, once you get good, you can solve these just by the proton NMR. But the instructions also ask you to assign peaks in carbon NMR and also ask you to do something with the mass spec problem. But just look at the IR. What do you see? Well, first off, it's formula given. Yes, it is. So there is oxygen. This is like an OH to me. What else do you see in the IR? It almost looks like it's only to the right, a little bit here. But if you're looking for aromatics, can we look at the protons? Does the proton show aromatic? That's probably 7 to 8. Here's your aromatics. What about carbon NMR? Does it show aromatic? What is this range here? Aromatic. So what's your favorite aromatic ring?
Benzene.
How many substituents on this ring?
Two.
How do you know two? But these are the same questions we did several times going through the packet. How many substituents?
Two.
Two. Are they ortho, meta, or para?
Para.
How do you know they're para?
Two is the doublets.
Yeah. I told you, classical pair of doublets. Anytime you hear the term classical, that should come with exclamation points. Very common classical pair of doublets. Okay, we saw that. So we get this fragment. Well, that's six carbons. How many total in the compound? All right, is there a carbonyl in the compound?
No, because you know this.
How many DUS in the compound?
Four, and benzene's four.
Four. There can't be a carbonyl, because there's four. Also, there's no carbonyl in the IR. There's also no carbonyl in the carbon anymore. there's no carbonyl. Then I would focus on proton. What do these signals tell you? That's a quartet 2H. What does that tell you? Probably a CH2. Why is it a quartet?
CH3.
Three neighbors. So we can start putting up the fragments, just like before. Okay, we're out of time. Hopefully everybody's worked this and has written down your questions, but I'm kind of doubting that. On Wednesday, at the beginning of class, we'll see what type of questions were here. And we'll see what type of structure you came up with. You may have already looked at the answer. Maybe that was 2 or 3 weeks ago. Do it as if you do not have the answer. There's also problems in the workbook. We'll see what type of questions were about those on Wednesday. Okay?